Okay, so this is going to be a funny video. The premise here is there is a website called logicallyfallacious.com. It's a site that lists logical fallacies. A while ago, the person who runs that site, Bo Bennett, got in a kind of argument or discussion or whatever with one of the members of my Discord, Saganism. Now, this resulted in Bo contacting me. They had gotten in an argument about Name the Trait, so I went on voice with him in Discord for like an hour or something. I had an email exchange that was somewhat extensive, and funny enough, even Philosophical Vegan got in on it. And basically, we were all just completely destroying this guy. And he is, in my opinion, you don't have the evidence for this yet, so you'll have to, you know, make your own evaluation. You can go probably interact with him on his site and judge for yourself. In my evaluation, this person is just a massive sophist. He's incredibly dishonest. He's incredibly evasive. He's just a weasel. So we wrecked him really badly, and the end result is he's actually written a book with a section about Name the Trait. I kid you not. So what I'm going to do in this video is go through that section and destroy everything that he says, and this video also serves as a debate challenge. Bo, don't be a weaselly little coward. Come to have a public debate, and I will destroy you live. If not, I think we can all assume that you can't defend your ridiculous position. Now, having said that, let's rip this cringy Holocaust apologia to shreds. Okay, so I think what I'm going to do is read through the Name the Trait section of the book part by part, and then reply at the end of each part. Okay, so, Name the Trait. Vegan YouTuber Ask Yourself revised Singer's version of the argument from Marginal Cases. The formal argument is a more complicated version of Singer's argument that introduces the idea of trait equalization. One advantage of the argument is that it makes room for moral factors other than just moral status. Recall that the use of moral value comprises moral status, effective moral value, and social moral value. The formal presentation of the argument follows. For all non-logicians out there, you can substitute on pain of P and not P with on contradiction. This argument is valid, but the soundness is arguable for reasons that we will explore. And then he's got version 5 of the argument there. Okay, so not a whole lot to say so far, just two comments. So firstly, whether you consider Name the Trait its own argument or a version of the argument from Marginal Cases like Bo does is actually a bit debatable. I personally don't care, it makes no difference to me, but it's just worth pointing out. Name the Trait has been formalized, whereas Marginal Cases was never formalized by Singer, as far as I'm aware. So it's a bit vague where exactly the borders are on what constitutes a marginal case argument, and you may think that Name the Trait falls within those borders or outside of those borders. So that's one thing. And then the other thing I wanted to point out is that he seems to think that an advantage of Name the Trait over Marginal Cases is that it allows you to use factors like moral status, effective moral value, and social moral value. Now, I don't know how he defines all those things, but it's not clear to me why this would be disallowed when we're talking about the argument from Marginal Cases. So I'm not sure that that's really an advantage. Alright, let's go to the next section. Trait equalization. The trait equalization process is a thought experiment rather than something that is possible in reality. It is the process of understanding the two organisms, each as a collection of distinct traits, which can be anything true of the organisms, then switching the traits one at a time until the human and the animal have switched places or until moral value was lost in the human. Consider the example of a pig and a human. The meat eater will claim that the human has full moral value, but the pig has less moral value, or no moral value. As we take each trait of the pig and switch it with a human trait, at what point does the human lose its full moral value? It can also be asked, at what point does the pig gain full moral value? Does a human with a pig snout have moral value? What about a pig with a human body? How about an articulate pig with a human intellect? Are these even valid questions? Okay, so the description there isn't too weird. There's just one or two little things I'd point out. So first of all, he says that it's a thought experiment rather than something that's possible in reality. Now, it's not clear what exactly he means by possible, but it's certainly logically possible, as in it doesn't entail a contradiction. So that's worth pointing out. And it's also kind of strange. He's not clear, really, about whose traits are being swapped. I mean, he makes it sound like maybe you're changing traits about both beings at the same time or something. Like, when does the pig gain value? When does the human lose value? So just to give everyone a clear picture of what we're talking about with trait equalization, you can take being A and being B, and there is some big stack of traits that they both have, right? Now, what we would do is equalize one being to the other. You don't, like, equalize them both at the same time or something like this. So you take being A, and you go through that stack of traits, and anywhere where you find a difference in traits between that being A and the other being B, you switch the property of A to match B. So B doesn't get altered at any point. You just gradually modify the traits of A until it has the same traits as B. And then at the end, he asks, are these even valid questions? Well, unless you're going to say that one of these questions contains a contradiction or something, then the questions are about situations that are logically possible, and I can't see why it would be invalid to ask about something that is logically possible. Let's continue. What is a human? The interlocutors should agree on the necessary and sufficient conditions for something to be considered human. This is to prevent the nonsensical label of human or person being applied to an organism that, by no reasonable definition of the word, is human. In our pig-to-human example, at some point in the equalization process, the human can no longer reasonably be considered a human, but a hybrid of a human and a pig. Eventually, what was once the human becomes the pig. This is a problem because it makes the common questions asked nonsensical in that we can never, not even in a thought experiment, have an articulate pig with a human intellect. It wouldn't be a pig. It would be a hybrid being that wouldn't quite fit either category. This doesn't make the exercise of trait equalization invalid. It just makes the questions asked invalid. As long as we word the question in a way that doesn't force a species on the hypothetical organism, we can avoid this problem. For example, does an organism with the body of a pig and the intellect of a human have moral value? In light of this species identity problem, the answer to the question, at what point does the human lose its full moral value, would be at no point, because the point at which moral value is lost, the hypothetical organism is no longer a human. A valid question would be, at what point does the human lose its humanity? The difference is subtle, but significant. Asking when a human loses moral value begs the question that we can have a human with no moral value, whereas asking when a human loses humanity assumes no such claim. What we are left with is a hybrid organism with no or little moral value. Okay, so this is just Bo being an obnoxious pedant. I've been through this with him repeatedly. I know full well that he understands why this isn't a good objection, but he just keeps making it. It's extremely obnoxious. So what he's doing here is he's saying, look, sometimes name the trait is asked in the following way. If we switch all the traits true of a human to match those true of an animal, at what point does the human lose moral value? Now he's saying that implies that the human loses moral value at some point when it's still a human, right? It's not that maybe it loses value somewhere later in the trait equalization process after it has stopped becoming a human. Now, the reason this is so obnoxious is that Bo has seen the actual name the trait documents. He's been through the dialogue tree, he's been through the deduction tree, and he knows full well that when we're technical about the question, we ask it such that it doesn't have that implication. That's just a way that the question is condensed down when we want to say it in a quick, easy way that the average person will understand. Obviously, if you read how the question is actually phrased on the dialogue flow tree, which was available long before he wrote this and which he has personally seen, you would see that what it says is, on your current moral view, if all the traits true of a given human who doesn't have moral value are switched to match those true of a given non-human animal who has moral value, is there any point in the trait equalization process where moral value is lost, right? So when you ask it like that, it does not imply that the being is still a human when moral value is lost. So this is just Bo taking cheap shots at a straw man of the actual argument based on a colloquial phrasing of the question instead of the proper phrasing that we would use in a technical situation, which he had full access to. Shameful. Another thing to point out is that the uncharitable interpretation of the question, when does a human lose moral value, that Bo is taking in order to criticize it, could be applied just as much to the question that he proposes as valid. When does a human lose humanity? Doesn't that question, by your insane standard, beg the question in the exact same way by assuming that there is such thing as a human without humanity? It's a stupid objection, Bo. The fact that the example valid question that you generate is susceptible to the exact same criticism under an uncharitable interpretation that you applied to my question just shows that the natural way that you think about those very strings of words is not that they imply that the property, humanity, or value is lost while the thing is still a human. All right, let's continue. Evaluating the soundness of the argument. The argument is used to attempt to get the interlocutor to reach a slightly different conclusion, but one with significant implications. If humans have moral value, then so must animals. Rather than considering just the properties of moral status, we can, according to the author of the argument, use anything true of a given being as it pertains to moral evaluations. Since we already explored this same argument with moral status, we will focus on the other factors in moral value. Let's apply our principle of charity to this argument. First, like with the other arguments, the animals we are referring to are the animals commonly eaten, not sea sponges or other plant-like animals. Second, it doesn't matter if there are degrees of moral value or not, because the claim is that no moral value is being lost when moving from a marginal case of a human, the marginal case is implied, to an animal. If one can demonstrate that moral value is lost in the trade equalization process, then the argument has been defeated, and a new argument will need to be made if it is suspected that the person is being inconsistent within their own moral framework. Before we get there, however, let's look at the possible objections to the premises, or why one could suggest that moral value is not retained in the trait equalization process. Okay, so this is where Bo starts to really lose the plot. He says, the argument is used to attempt to get the interlocutor to reach a slightly different conclusion. Slightly different than what? What are you talking about? But one with significant implications. If humans have moral value, then so must animals. Well, no, Bo, that's not the conclusion of the argument, and that's not an implication of the conclusion of the argument. If you actually look at the deduction tree, you'll see the conclusion is, therefore your view can only deny the given non-human animal has moral value on pain of contradiction. That is not a general statement that if humans have moral value, so must animals, and it's also not the case that that general statement is an implication of the conclusion. So you're just wrong. You have no idea what you're talking about. You've also said that we can use anything true of a given being as it pertains to moral evaluation. Well, what do you mean as it pertains to moral evaluation? You can just use anything true of the being in the hypothetical, right? It's not like you can use some subset of those things. And when you add that weird caveat, which funny enough in the footnote, you've said you added for clarity, it actually makes the argument less clear. Right? You can use anything true of the being in the hypothetical. It's not just some subset of things true of the being that you can use, which is what it sounds like when you say as it pertains to moral evaluation. Okay, then down below, you say, it doesn't matter if there are degrees of moral value or not, because the claim is that no moral value is being lost when moving from a marginal case of a human to an animal. Okay, so this is just a writing tip for you, Bo. After you write a sentence, just ask yourself, is this sentence intelligible from an outside perspective? When you just refer to things like the claim or a slightly different conclusion, we don't know what you're talking about. A slightly different conclusion than what? What claim? Who's making the claim? What are you talking about? Now, if you're suggesting that it's some kind of problem for the argument if someone thinks that moral value gradually decreases as you move from a human to an animal, I don't know why that would be a problem, right? So think of the initial question. The initial question is just asking, is there some point in the trait equalization process where moral value is lost, right? Now, either that's the case or that's not the case. It could be that moral value decreases in degrees throughout the trait equalization process, but it's still either the case or not that at some point value disappears altogether, okay? This objection seems to me similar to someone saying that asking whether a light is on or off doesn't make sense if there's a dimmer switch. It's like, what? It doesn't matter if the light can be brighter or dimmer or whatever. It's still either on or off, right? So asking if it's on or off is a completely coherent question. So just no idea what you're talking about. No idea who's supposed to be making the claim or why you think that degrees of value would pose some kind of problem for name the trait. It's just convoluted nonsense. And down below, you are extremely confused. Like, this comment that I'm about to go over is the worst confusion so far. It indicates complete lack of comprehension of the dialogue flow tree, the deduction tree, and how they function together. Okay, so you say, if one can demonstrate that moral value is lost in the trade equalization process, then the argument has been defeated. What are you talking about? Look, Bo, I'm going to walk you through this step by step, and I want you to just play this back as many times as you have to until you understand why that's an incredibly stupid thing to say, okay? The dialogue flow tree opens with a question. The only time when the deduction is presented to you, the argument, right, is if you say no to that first question in the dialogue flow tree. If you say no to the first question in the dialogue flow tree, you're saying humans have value, animals don't, and there's no point in the trade equalization process where moral value is lost, okay? If then, once presented with the deduction, you say, oh, actually there is a point in the trade equalization process where moral value is lost, sure, the argument no longer applies to you, right? Because you don't hold the kind of position that's described in premise two of the argument, but you've contradicted yourself, right? You contradicted one of the statements that was necessary for the deduction to come up in the first place, namely that there is no point in the trait equalization process where moral value is lost. So contradicting yourself such that the deduction no longer applies to you is far from defeating the argument, right? That's just saying something, getting an argument against the position, then contradicting yourself so the argument doesn't apply to you, right? This argument would never be given to someone who thinks that there's a point in the trade equalization process where value is lost. Saying that there's no point so that the deduction is presented to you, and then claiming there is a point so the deduction no longer applies to you, is not defeating the argument. It's just contradicting yourself such that the deduction no longer applies to you. And if the deduction no longer applies to you, that just means we're going down the other arm of the dialogue flow tree. So just incredible, incredible confusion there. Really unbelievable stuff. Let's move to the next section. Objections to premise one. The first premise is a hypothetical, meaning that we cannot reject the premise if the if condition, the antecedent, is false. For example, if the premise stated, if the moon is made of green cheese, then it would be a dairy product. It would be tempting to argue that the moon is not made of green cheese and reject the premise, but logically we couldn't. We could reject the premise if we felt that what came after, the then, the consequent, did not follow, such as claiming that if the moon were made of green cheese, it could be some type of vegan cheese. The point of all this is that if our view does not affirm a given human is trait equalizable, then we'll have to leave that objection for the second premise. As far as claiming that what comes after the then in the premise does not logically follow would be a difficult claim to make since the consequent is the logical outcome of the antecedent. The premise assumes that humans are trait equalizable with animals, humans have moral value, and moral value is not lost in the trait equalization process. The logical outcome of this is that animals will have moral value. Regarding premise one, it should be accepted as true. Right, so that's all fine. An easier way to explain it would just be to show the truth table for a conditional statement and just show that the conditional will still evaluate to true if the antecedent is false. The conditional will only be false if the antecedent is true and the consequent is false. Continuing now, objections to premise two. Here is where we can object to the antecedent in the first premise, because the second premise is a confirmation of the hypothetical presented in premise one. Consider this argument. One, if your view affirms that your race is superior to all other races, then you are a racist. Two, your view affirms that your race is superior to all others. Three, therefore, you are a racist. Although this is a valid argument, assuming you are not a racist, it is not sound because the second premise is not true. Therefore, we can reject the argument. Likewise, it could be the case that our view does not affirm a given human is trait equalizable to a given non-human animal while retaining moral value. If this is the case, the argument would be unsound as it relates to the person considering the argument. I want to stress that last part again. Since the second premise is contingent on the subjective view of the person addressing the argument, all it takes for the argument to be considered unsound is for the person addressing the argument to claim that their view does not affirm a given human is trait equalizable to a given non-human animal while retaining moral value. From here, the formalized name the trait argument has run its course, and new arguments are needed to check if the interlocutor's response is constant with their moral framework. Right, so that's true, but Bo seems to completely lack any comprehension of how the dialogue flow tree and the deduction tree function together. The deduction tree only comes up if you say no to the first question in the dialogue flow tree, which means that you do hold the kind of view that's described in premise two. The deduction tree is not meant to be presented as a standalone such that it can be trivially rejected by anyone who doesn't hold the view. This is why you use the dialogue flow tree. Give them the dialogue flow. If they say no to the first question, they've placed themselves in the category of views described in premise two of the deduction tree, then you run the deduction. If they then want to try to get out of the deduction, they have to actually contradict the initial statements, one of the initial statements that put them there, such as that there's no point in the trade equalization process where value is lost. So this is just incredibly silly, right? He's taking the argument as if it's a standalone and saying, well, anyone who doesn't have the kind of view described in premise two can just reject the argument. Yeah, no shit. That's why you run the dialogue flow tree, and the deduction tree only comes up if someone says no to the first question. Maybe an analogy would help. Say that there is a deduction that says, if you believe in Christianity, then you're a theist. You believe in Christianity, therefore you're a theist. And say that that argument came with a corresponding dialogue flow where you're only meant to deliver that deduction if someone says that they believe in Christianity. Imagine then completely ignoring the dialogue flow tree and saying, oh, well, this argument is trivially easy to reject. If someone doesn't accept Christianity, then the argument doesn't apply to them. It's just hilariously stupid. Very, very silly, Bo. Let's move along. Reasoning from an imaginary world to the real world. Consider the following argument. If in some imaginary world plants had the same level of sentience as humans, it would be immoral to eat them. Two, in some imaginary world, plants do have the same level of sentience as humans. Three, therefore, it is immoral to eat plants. This is a non sequitur because the conclusion does not follow from the premises. The argument is invalid. To make it valid, we would need to change the conclusion to, therefore, it is immoral to eat plants in this imaginary world. Demonstrating that it is immoral to eat plants in an imaginary world says nothing about the morality of eating plants in this world. We can reject the name the trait argument based on the fact that a given human is not trait equalizable to a given non-human animal, regardless of moral status. We cannot take the traits from an animal and swap them with traits from a human to create a hybrid creature in this world. This is not the same as gene modification through technologies like CRISPR. For example, while humans can exist with the cognitive capacity of a cow, we cannot put a human mind into a cow. We can posit a hypothetical world where this would be possible, but we are not extending that concept of the hypothetical world to the rest of the argument. Thus, we are committing a fallacy by implying an alternative world in the first premise and this world in the second premise and conclusion. To correct this, the argument would have to be rewritten as follows. 1. If your view affirms that in a hypothetical world, a given human is trait equalizable to a given non-human animal while retaining moral value, then your view can only deny the given non-human animal has moral value in that hypothetical world on pain of P and not P. 2. Your view affirms a given human is trait equalizable to a given non-human animal while retaining moral value in a hypothetical world. 3. Therefore, your view can only deny the given non-human animal has moral value in a hypothetical world on pain of P and not P. If such a world existed, where pigs with human minds can exist, then we would need to rethink our moral hierarchy seriously. But because such a world does not exist, we don't need to worry about it. Oh dear God. Okay, so two very basic errors here. So the first is you say that the argument would become valid if the conclusion were changed to, therefore, it is immoral to eat plants in this imaginary world. That is false. The argument would still be invalid. Okay, so if we represent this argument with some propositional variables, we'll say that this first proposition, in some imaginary world, plants have the same level of sentience as humans, is P. We'll call this second proposition, it would be immoral to eat them, Q. And we'll call the proposition that you're proposing for the conclusion R, because it's not identical to P or Q. If we sub in R for the conclusion, we're going to get the form P implies Q, P therefore R, which is of course invalid. To make the argument valid, you would need to change not just the conclusion, you would need to change the consequent in the first premise to be the same as the conclusion. So you are wrong when you say that the argument would become valid if you change just the conclusion. You have to change the conclusion and the consequent of the first premise. Now you make an even more hilarious error down below where you say that it's possible to say that the animal has value in the hypothetical, so you could only say it doesn't have value in the hypothetical on pain of contradiction, but in the actual world, maybe the animal doesn't have value, so it's not a contradiction to deny it value. Well, that is just not understanding how the hypothetical is constructed. When we construct the hypothetical, the propositions about the animal that we have in the actual world are the same propositions that we import into the hypothetical. So if you at the end say something like, oh, well, the animal has the proposition of having moral value in the hypothetical, but not in the actual world, well, that just means you didn't construct the hypothetical correctly from the first place, because the way we construct it is by copy-pasting the set of propositions true of the animal in the actual world into the hypothetical. So, nice big facepalm there. Let's continue. Mind games. If one is a dualist, they believe that the mind can exist independent of the physical brain, biological or artificial, as in some advanced AI. However, monism is virtually universally accepted by all those who work in the field of brain science. That is, it is well understood that the mind is the result of the physical brain. We can manipulate the brain, which results in predictable changes in the mind. Most people with religious beliefs are dualists who believe in a soul, or at least the idea that the mind is distinctively separate from the brain. This allows for the idea of an afterlife without the need for a physical body. But once we bring religion or metaphysics into the argument, as we have seen, one can simply claim that people have souls and animals don't, which is why it's not immoral to kill them for food, and the argument is over. The vegetarian can also hold a dualist view and claim that a human mind can exist in an animal in some world. This would be an attempt to make the meat eater's position appear absurd by claiming they are willing to murder disabled human minds or some similar characterization. A simple solution is for the meat eater to include the human mind as a trait that is lost in the process. However, if the vegetarian demands that the meat eater unpack human mind, example, what is it about a mind that makes it human, then the argument won't be able to progress, because we already know that the dualist vegetarian won't accept the scientifically accurate explanation that it is the human brain and biology that makes the mind human. The idea that some advanced computer would be capable of replicating the human mind is not too far-fetched, but it would still be hardware vastly more complex than any animal's organic hardware, which would give the AI the capacity to replicate the human mind, and even then the question of the humanity of the mind would be quite debatable. No matter how one tries to sell it, non-human animals with human minds cannot exist in this world any more than a non-round circle can exist. Okay, so a few things. Firstly, he makes some claims about how widely held dualism and monism are in different communities, brain science community, religious community. Now, I don't know if those claims are true. They could very well be. I'm just pointing out I'm not sure if they're true. He claims that dualists believe that the mind can exist without the brain. This is false. A dualist does not need to believe that the mind can exist without the brain. A dualist simply needs to believe that the mind and the brain are separate substances. It could still be that one substance depends on the other. Now, he says that if someone names the trait not having a soul, the argument is over. That's, of course, false. Now, don't get me wrong, there are very good pathways you can go down when someone tries to do that are outside of the realm of name the trait. So if someone says the trait is not having a soul, you could move outside of the argument and just say, oh, well, I'm not convinced that souls exist at all. Like, I don't know that humans have souls. Can you give me a case for that? And then you can enter a debate about souls and make someone look silly for saying souls exist, or maybe even get them to abandon the notion that souls exist and then return to name the trait in such a way that they can no longer name that trait. But on the other hand, you can actually just keep going with the argument. The argument certainly doesn't need to be over at that point. You can just say, oh, okay, I grant that souls exist, but I'm not sure where exactly a soul is lost in the trait equalization process. Where is that? Now, if they have no idea at all, then they're going to have to say that they're morally ambiguous about a being that is subjectively identical to a human and that is physically identical to a human, except that being has a cow tail, right? Does that being have a soul? Well, we don't know, so it's not clear if that being has value. Maybe it's just fine to Holocaust duns them. We're not sure. That's an absurdity. Now, if they say they do know where the soul is lost, and then they point out some specific place, then you're going to have just a standard reductio. Now, the other confusion that is involved in here is he seems to say that it's impossible for an animal to have a human mind. Now, this is just a confusion over what it means for something to be possible or impossible. We're talking about logical possibility. So there's not a contradiction entailed by saying that this is an animal with a human mind. It could be the case that that is not physically possible. In fact, I would assume that it's not physically possible for an animal brain to generate a human mind. But we're talking about logical possibility here, not physical possibility. So that's just irrelevant. So when he makes this analogy between a non-human animal with a human mind and a non-round circle, he's actually confused. A non-human animal with a human mind is logically possible. That doesn't entail a contradiction. A non-round circle is not logically possible. So you can say both aren't physically possible, but when we're talking about logical possibility, the one is logically possible, the other is not. Continuing, summary of the name the trade argument. The name the trade argument is a more complicated version of Singer's argument that introduces the hypothetical exercise of trait equalization. The conclusion of the argument states that one can only deny an animal moral value if they also deny some humans, marginal cases, moral value. The trait equalization process introduces a problem of identity by adhering to labels such as human and animal when referring to sometimes impossible hybrid organisms. This results in drawing conclusions about humans and animals from impossible hybrid creatures that cannot exist in reality. If the trait equalization process does result in an impossible being, the entire argument can be rejected based on this objection that the world implied is an equivocation between an imaginary world and the real world, resulting in a non sequitur, i.e., the conclusion not following from the premises. The first premise poses a hypothetical so we can accept it as true and object to the antecedent, i.e., if your view affirms a given human is trait equalizable to a given non-human animal while retaining moral value. In the second premise, where it declares that the antecedent is the case, if one's view does not affirm that a given human is trait equalizable to a given non-human animal while retaining moral value, then the second premise can be rejected with no further justification needed within the context of this argument. But justifying such a claim will require that this conversation continue. Even if we were to agree with the conclusion, like the other arguments, this still does not get us to the immorality of killing animals for food. To get us to the next level, no matter how we answer this question, we need some supplemental arguments. Okay, and the summary is just a repetition of the same errors from before. So he claims that NTT is just a version of AMC. That just depends on how broadly you construe AMC. Doesn't really matter to me, but it is debatable, so you shouldn't state it like it's a fact. He says that the conclusion of name the trait is that one can only deny an animal moral value if they also deny some humans moral value. That's false. The conclusion is that therefore your view can only deny the given non-human animal has moral value on pain of P and not P. He claims that the trait equalization process involves impossible beings. He's just confusing physical possibility and logical possibility. He hasn't shown that any of those beings actually result in a contradiction. And then he's also stated that you can reject the argument by saying that your view is not the view described in the second premise. This just shows a lack of comprehension of how the dialogue flow tree and the deduction tree fit together. Obviously, you only get presented with the deduction if you say no to the first question in the dialogue flow tree, which involves affirming that there is no point in the trait equalization process where value is lost. If you then say, oh, there is such a point, you're just contradicting the statement that got the deduction presented to you in the first place. The deduction is not meant to be run as a standalone. It's only meant to be run if someone says no to the first question in the dialogue flow tree. And when you say that the argument doesn't get you to the position that killing animals for food is wrong, you're just not understanding how the argument is supposed to work. I really encourage you to go watch the video where I explain the argument carefully. I'll link it down below. If you're talking to someone who thinks that animals do have moral value, but not sufficient moral value, that it's wrong to murder them for food, then you run the exact same argument, same dialogue flow tree, same deduction tree, but you take every instance where the term moral value is used, and you replace it with sufficient moral value that it's wrong to kill the being in question for food. And even then, the conclusion that you reach is that your view can only deny the given non-human animal has moral value on pain of contradiction. The conclusion isn't, therefore it's wrong to eat animals. And Bo, I have told you this. This has all been explained to you. So, good try, Bo, but you failed, and if you think that you can actually defend your nonsense objections to name the trait in debate, I would love to wreck you. So feel free to hit me up. You have my contact information. If you guys like this kind of content, then consider supporting on Patreon. There's also merch down below. The Teespring link goes to the merch store. That's all for today. Till next time.